dreams have come true.
The Ride with JMV on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Hey, Wednesday. Thank you so much. We got a lot to talk about. Pacers, you thought it was going to be the same old, and then they busted out of that. And that was good. I know Toronto wasn't really working with anything last night, but when you are trending as the Pacers have and being a team like that that opens up games, whether at home or on the road against teams that eyeballing the roster much worse than what they are, playing down to the competition, getting up off that mat. And you can know Rick Carlisle was angry. Rick Carlisle was angry. They got up off of it, got a win, maintained six, and then you got a bunch of junk going on around you. So Friday in Cleveland, looks like Donovan Mitchell is going to be back for that. I think he's playing later on tonight. We'll give you tonight's schedule because you can do a little bit of scoreboard watching. Not a lot of help last night in a couple of games that we'll talk about too. And then Giannis going down with the calf injury. I don't know. Ultimately, you look at Giannis and how that would affect. Right now, Boston is clear-cut in the Eastern Conference by a long shot, at least record-wise. But the effect that things could have here in the next, I don't know, handful of days could be for real, too. And once again, a shout-out to T.J. McConnell. I saw where LeBron James said right now one of the NBA players he really does enjoy watching is T.J. McConnell, described him as being Draymond Green-like, which I guess besides the part where you get technicals and you get tossed and you get suspended and you jack up a teammate, I guess it's all the other stuff that Draymond Green does. Like last night when everything was good for Golden State. Take it easy, Jake. When Golden State's on the road at L.A. and they win by a wide margin and they get to take their picture with Will Ferrell and hang out with Kim Kardashian and everybody celebrity-wise on the sideline. It was a good night for Draymond Green. What did he knock down? 5 threes, which he rarely does. So when it's good, everything's going good. But T.J. McConnell has been outstanding, and I brought this up before, and I got to give credit with Chris DiNera, who's going to join us at 4 o'clock. He and Quinn were the first ones to bring up off-the-bench recognition, and I'll leave it at that. Because the award is Sixth Man of the Year, and we all know that he's not going to get that. But for God's sake, can you give the guy a little bit of recognition? He has been major. He has been large in so many different ways. So bench recognition, there's no award for that. In fact, I'm just making that stuff up right now. But how about a little bit of recognition for that? I bet you. I bet you if you look across the NBA landscape right now and you look at guys that come off the bench, and I know you're going to look at the raw numbers and guys are going to stick out better than others. But has there been anybody you think? We could throw around some names if you like, and I'm sure Chris will coming up here at the top of the 4 o'clock hour, but has there been anybody that has been so impactful for their team? And I know that we have been hardcore watching the Pacers all year, so we would know before everybody else, and that's the reason why he probably doesn't get more love than what he does right now. I mean, hell, half of you out there wanted to trade him at the beginning of the season because you cried about the minutes that were going to be taken away from younger players, yet you forgot about why we're here is to win games. And that's what he brings. He brings an edge, he brings an impact, and he helps you win games. He also, and I thought Miles said this a couple of nights ago when he said he's one of one. He is one of one. It's good to have an original. I don't know how impactful he might be in other situations on other teams, but certainly here he has been that. So bench recognition, I think, is all that we're looking for. We'll talk to Chris about that coming up at the top of the 4 o'clock hour. Pacers 140-123 last night, knocking off the Toronto Raptors. It wasn't good. You go back to the first quarter, he trailed 35-25. I'm telling you, it was a familiar script. And then then started, I wouldn't say taking control, but 40-29 in the second quarter was the big deal, and then basically they were off and running. They had a 40-point second, a 41-point third, and that was more Pacer-like. That's what you expect. Tyrese Halliburton had 30. That's why I mentioned all these games here down the stretch, the final eight that I made so much about for basically the better part of a month. It's not just for what you want to see in the standings or for the sake of us being able to scoreboard watch, right? Later on tonight, see what other teams around them are doing in the Eastern Conference. It is for, and a lot of people laugh at this. I don't care if you do. It is for the momentum. Momentum, what it does, it translates into confidence. Confidence translates into wins. When momentum is sustained, that means confidence is sustained, and you're going to get a hell of a lot of winning. So to me, it's really not had a great deal to do. I want to see them where they are. I don't want to see them in the play-in. You know, either maintain or maybe because of situations be able to move up. But what you want to do is have a team playing at their best. And the problem with the Pacers is you could look back and their best this season may go all the way back to early December. And that is even before Pascal Siakam was here. So you're talking about a huge factor in, and you want to see, which hopefully they're able to do, play at the best of their abilities, their best basketball this time of year. And then we'll let all this other stuff as far as the standing sort itself out, because it will when you win. But just be playing well. Now, last night, especially after that first quarter, and I got all the X's. All the X's said, oh, here we go again. JMV, the same old, same old. I'm going to have to shut it off. That's just who the Pacers are by now. Why doesn't Rick bench everybody? You got to bench everybody, Rick. And granted, you look at Toronto, they didn't have much. But you also look at the way the Pacers have handled teams like Toronto. In fact, how they've handled Toronto prior to. You look at that. I don't know if it's the type of growth that you want to see it be so incredibly proud of, but it's better than the alternative. And again, it helps sustain the momentum that is built, because on Sunday you go out and you beat Miami. You have an incredible first half, and then Miami makes you play basically how they want to play in the second, but you were able to maintain enough to survive and get past and put yourself in the best position possible. And the last thing you wanted to see happen was basically erase that from memory if you went out last night and crapped the bed. There was no bed crapping. Couple of 40-point, 140-plus, 140-point quarter in the second and the third got that done. And I want to see that type of momentum that we saw early, especially from Tyrese Halliburton. Because we all wondered if Tyrese Halliburton, if he was tired, if he was still kind of injured, if other teams have caught up, the advanced scout, has it caught up with him? You kind of wonder all of this, but last night and here in particular as of late, his ability that we saw earlier this season that impressed basically the NBA world, the basketball world, has become more prominent at the right time. Get the ball and you go, get the ball and you get around, get the ball and you step back and knock down a three. I think the passing certainly has been a lot more on the money. That is such a huge deal. I've said this all along. The one dude you cannot live without under these circumstances is him, because he is the power for everybody. He's the reason why all these guys get going, whether you're talking about Siakam or Miles or Nembhard playing off of him or Aaron Nesmith, you know, doing the dirty work defensively but also playing off of him. Without him, that's a big deal. And then the pace, which has become so exclusive that we enjoy so much with the Pacers offensively. Now, that pace has to be maintained. And that's also another reason why TJ McConnell has been so good off the bench. He's able to maintain an optimum pace for this team to perform. And that is the level in which we have come to know. And when things are going right, we have been massively impressed. Again, that's what makes him so perfect here. I don't know how he would work anyplace else. I would assume that if he went someplace else, like let's just say, for example, some of you nerds and dorks out there got your wish earlier this season or before the start of the season and traded him to Phoenix or traded him and Miles to the Lakers like Rob Pelinka, I think, was trying to do. Like if you would have got your wish and then got all these bench guys playing time so they can get worked over because they're not ready for prime time, you know, all that stuff that leads to losing that everybody's used to around here. If you dorks would have got your wish regarding that, I would assume that McConnell would adapt to wherever he is. But he is perfect right here. He is perfect for what he brings. And even if you're not talking about his three-point shooting prowess, who cares? He's able to maintain that pace. When Halliburton goes out, they're still running it. And you saw that against Miami when they, by their own accord or by the other team's defense, when they decelerate, they're just simply not close to as good. And in fact, when they decelerate, they're almost kind of boring. Because you want to see them get out and get going offensively. That's how they play. You want to see the ball move. You want to see them score quickly. Siakam has become certainly more of the mix in doing that. But that's what you want to see. And that, why, to me, is why TJ McConnell has just worked so well here. Yeah, I'm glad that the Pacers did the right thing. And I am glad that Chris and Quinn brought up the whole sixth man of the year thing, and I know he's not going to get that, but certainly recognition should be there. And we have rarely, if ever in our lives, said shout out to LeBron James, but good for LeBron James for noticing that. Now maybe somebody else will, besides us. And good for TJ as well. Cleveland on the road coming up on Friday. Closeout on Sunday against the Atlanta Hawks. We'll go over a myriad of scenarios with Chris coming up here at the top of the hour. So 36 nationally televised games. That is what we're talking about with the Indiana Fever, which certainly is the Caitlin Clark effect. That is beyond impressive right there. And by the way, too, absolutely worth its weight. And I know some of you are very skeptical about the impact that Caitlin Clark was going to have and still longer term could have. But you take all this and you run with it. I was mentioning to the fellas when we were doing our crosstalk segment, I loved listening to Aaliyah Boston as a part of the Final Four and the championship game coverage. I thought she was outstanding. I could listen to her talk basketball all day. Yeah, maybe not so much Sue Bird or whatever. What's her nuts? What is it? Who's the other one that's with her on the ESPN broadcast? Sue Bird and, yeah, whatever. But I could listen to her. She sounds so informed. And, again, she was talking about her former team, which, you know, obviously you should be very informed. But I thought she sounded really good in that Final Four coverage. But here's how it breaks down. You get 36 of 40 games for the Fever on nationally. Diana Taurasi is the other one. My bad. 36 of 40. So I think how it goes here, 13 on NBA TV, 8 on ION. Where the hell's ION? I used to know where ION was. It was someplace where I always saw it, and I always glanced over it. I have no idea where it is. And again, I'm talking about DirecTV. And no, it's not next to the Hustler channel. I don't know where ION is. So 8 on ION, 5 on ESPN, 2 on ABC, 2 on CBS, 1 on CBS Sports. And you're going to, I guess you're going to have to pay to watch, right? You get 4 on Prime? Prime Video right there. I want to say, how many did they have a year ago? They have 15 or over? Last year, how many nationally televised games they have last year?
For the Fever? Yeah. I think it was just one, is what I read.
Oh, James. I don't know, considering all these channels. Maybe it was just one. You might be right. Yes, only one. James is right. Hold the phone. ABC, CBS, and ESPN, only one. They had 18 with all the other avenues in which you can watch, and with ION, if you can find where ION is. But, man, good for the Fever. And, yeah, good for the summertime for everybody, too. Get that thing going. Have a little fun with it. But 36 of 40 games, the draft coming up next week. There certainly is a lot going on. The transfer portal continues to move. Ethan Morton of Purdue is, at least the latest that I have seen, fell out of the rotation. Obviously, Matt Painter, at a point during the season, decided to go of a more offensive lean, and Heidi played a lot more. You know, Miles Colvin was playing a lot more. You know, go along with Mason Gillis. So Morton fell out of the rotation. I think the last time he played is when he went in and fouled either, you know, was that Gonzaga or Tennessee when he went in and fouled and came back out. But Ethan Morton is now in the transfer portal with about a zillion others. And basically all of Terre Haute's in there too. All of Terre Haute. People ask me all the time if I'm mad. Are you mad at Josh Schertz? I'm not really mad at anybody. And I know you're going to say, well, that's just your school. You're not going to be. No. I've long since been mad at the president, and I had given up on that. I can't wait until she's gone. The moment she hits whatever transfer portal she's going to be in, good riddance to Deb. So there is where I would be mad, because a lot of things that have been handled have not been handled well by her. Others have fallen on the sword because of her. So it's going to be good, although the dude, I guess, that they believe is going to take her place was with her at two different stops, so who the hell knows how that's going to go. Now, I'll get mad if they start making Indiana State and Terre Haute crap decisions again. That's when I'll be mad. That's when I'll get mad at him. I'm not mad at Josh Schertz because he gets paid more, and now he goes to a place where they have more NIL money. I got news for you. Most everybody out there would say, well, the reason why all these guys, and we'll just go ahead and hard target the five right here. The reason why they're starting five left is because their coach left. And I'm here to tell you that basically all five are going to leave anyway. Maybe one would stay, but all five were going to leave anyway. Why? Because their market value, when you have a couple, that would be in excess of $500,000. Two players at $500,000 apiece. Two other players at $250,000 apiece. And then we're, you know, somewhere well over $100,000 for another. No way. I don't know about the NIL situation at Indiana State. I'm assuming it probably had basically what I had in my pocket in 1992 over there, which is about $1.50. So I'm guessing. Maybe more than $1.50. But I'll be pissed if they can't understand now what a season like last year, albeit the NIT runner-up, what a season like that can do for your school, for how people view you, and for the relationship between the town and your school, which has been splintered over the years. That's when I'll get mad. Can you imagine me saying, hey, I can't believe you're going to go take all that money and have a better situation? Yeah, I think St. Louis as a whole, I hate the place. Can't stand it. And part of it, if not all of it, is because the Cardinals, I hate them, which I think we all do for the most part. Like, I don't think St. Louis is the hole that I would like to describe it to be. It's not like when I go to Michigan, and now I kind of have to like Michigan a little bit too, which is weird because it's dusty. Man, normally I can't stand that place. But all in all, it's about the Cardinals. But completely understand. And also, Here's what you got to do. In the world of the transfer portal, and I'm not telling basketball people anything they don't already know, because if you don't already know, you're a loser. And if you haven't already been a loser, you're going to consistently be a loser. You've got to jump in this pool, find a way to stay afloat and make it work. You have to adapt. I'm telling you, my friends, we all have to adapt. There's a lot of crap that I have to adapt to. I don't want to. I'm 54 years old. I kind of just want to sit on my ass and do whatever I want to do. I think I've earned that right. But it's not that easy. You're in a situation in which you have to adapt. And I don't care if it's Indiana State. I don't care if it's John Calipari now at Arkansas. I don't care if it's Kentucky and, you know, how much financially they have, the wealth of finances they have to do whatever they want. It does not matter. While the rules are the way the rules are, you better just learn to play the game or you're going to lose. And that's why I mentioned yesterday, and I have talked about this, when you have seasons like that and you're going through it, yeah, don't wait to jump on board. You got get involved in it. Have some fun with it. And especially for mid-majors, it's probably not going to be sustainable. Really, you can look at it like NIL and the transfer portal in general. One of these days, things will change because it's not sustainable either. Let's just say it's goofy. It's goofy as hell, and it turns a lot of people away. But then again, it's basketball, and those of us that love the game of basketball are going to sit and we're going to watch. With all that in mind, because you're sitting in it right now, you better learn to play the game. While you're in that pool, you better learn to swim. You'd probably go to jail for it now. I remember back, I didn't have a thing to do with it, but at my house, 1976, I'm 6 years old, and an in-ground pool, and it's back when it was like a cement pond, like the Beverly Hillbillies. It was awesome. I mean, because that's where I am, the Beverly Hillbillies. But it was great. For so many years, it was the party location. It was oasis in the sun, and if I would have hung a video camera in a tree right next to it for many years, I could have sold what went down there. It was glorious. But when that thing was first installed and filled with water from the volunteer fire department, awesome, the first thing that happened is people just pushed me in and said, hey, you got to learn to swim here. This is the pool. This is in your yard. You got to learn to swim. Nowadays, you'd probably go to jail for that. But all these schools that haven't been on board have been kicking and screaming or look at themselves in the mirror and go, oh, woe is us. We're a mid-major. Let's sit here and cry. Stop it right now and get busy. Get to work. Figure out what you can do. And I know that the odds are going to be stacked against you, like it's going to be stacked certainly coming up this year against Indiana State. But you need to start to figure out a path to maintain. And by the time maybe you do and you find success, it'll be evolving once again, and you'll have to evolve with that yourself. It's the way that it is. It's the business you're in. And when you're in it, you got to work. When you're in it, you got to play. And not just mid-majors, that's everybody. All right, 239-1070. We can talk about that coming up a little bit later on, too. A little MLB we can work in. Masters coverage, I don't know too much about it. Here's what I know. I know that when people say, hey, who do you think's going to win the Masters? Correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think I've done this in a while. But there was a point basically from 2013 to 2018 or 19, maybe a five-year span, where I picked Brant Snedeker every year for every major. I don't even know if that dude plays golf anymore. Here's the reason why. He came on this show once, and he was awesome. And I go, you know what? I'm going to pick this guy. He's going to win. He is going to win a major. And to my knowledge, he never did. Now, who's the kid from Vincennes? What's he, from South Knox High School? I think that's who I'm going to pick. I've never picked, and I believe he is from South Knox, unless he's from Vincennes. James, I know you're a big Knox County fan.
Is it Adam Schenck?
Adam Schenck. Where did he go to high school? South Knox?
It says he was born in Vincennes.
Born at Good Samaritan Hospital in Vincennes, Indiana?
I can't see on
his
Wikipedia.
How about a block from Bob's Pizza back in the day?
It doesn't
And where
say.
I lived at 9th and Busserin. I lived at 9th and Busserin when I was down there. See if he went to South Knox. I think he did. I'm a big fan of the K-Knoxes. North K-Knox and Bicknell and South K-Knox.
Yeah, you went to South Knox.
I have never thought to pick somebody from South Knox High School to win the Masters before. This is going to be a first time. Now, we'll go over that tomorrow. Ted Bishop going to join us coming up on tomorrow's show as it is officially underway. Get us all a little education from it. All right, 239-1070. I do have time for you on the other side. Chris Denari with a day off is going to join us coming up at 4. All these situations and the reason why we're scoreboard watching tonight and the rest of the regular season for the Pacers, sure, you got to continue to win, but we're also going to scoreboard watch. And credit where credit is due for the guy, the main guy coming off the bench. We'll do that with Chris Denari, top of the hour. Bowen's going to be here. If he can cut loose from what is, I'm sure, the eve of his most massive sports arousal, the Masters, Kev's going to join us coming up in the 5 o'clock hour as well. Pat Benatar, Neil Giraldo tickets we'll give away for the Everwise Amphitheater coming up later on this summer downtown. Got tickets for that, too. All right, the stream, the app, the AAA Membership Lounge via YouTube Live. We'll sign in and see what everybody is talking about coming up in just a minute. 239-1070 is the number. The email address is jmv@1075thefan.com. The stream, the app, HD Radio, scratching the surface on a Wednesday. Join us. Hang with us. 93.5-107.5 The Fan.
You love spring and Indy, but you hate to...
was in there. But it's weird and pissed off, whatever it is.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
You know, I looked at the schedule later on this week, and I love being in studio. But I much more would rather be out. I don't think I'm out later on this week. Who wants me? Seriously. What am I going to do on a Friday? I'll have to. I guess I could go down the hall. We have a, since we moved to the fourth floor here downtown, me and the fellas across the hall on the News Talk station, right? 93 WIBC. We have a little gathering before our respective shows every day when I'm here. So it kind of takes care of itself. But, man, I love being out. It's weird. It'd be weird on a Thursday and Friday not being anywhere. Jeff Stevens checks in with this. Class of 2016, South Knox. So I don't know what went down at South Knox, but their former, and not this year, but prior to this year, their basketball head coach, the boys' varsity, was David Burkett, friend of mine. Another Greene County, Eastern Greene County guy. So there was my connection to South Knox right there. Jim McCann in Southern California writes this, DirecTV no longer carries ION, so obviously that is the reason behind me not being able to find it. Thanks, Jim. Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. 305 is where you'll find it. All right. So it's on 305? See, I don't know what – I know where I can find – like 245, I know, is TNT. I don't know the numbers. I just go to various places and then scroll with the guide. That's what I do to find Reds games like last night. Last night, going back and forth between the Reds, and they stunk, and the Pacers, which was good. You know, I hit the back button for that. I'll get it on a couple of channels and hit the back button. But I did not know where ION had gone. Some skivvies. Hey, JMV, I hear what you're saying about McConnell. Not only should he be considered Sixth Man of the Year, but what about the Most Improved Award? I would just settle, and that's why, give credit where credit is due. I know everybody around here dislikes him, but LeBron James said, quote, one of my favorite players in the NBA right now is TJ McConnell. He's like Draymond Green, but a point guard. And you can say what you want. It's worth its weight whenever LeBron says it. So you probably dig LeBron a little bit more now because he said something nice about somebody that you like around here. That's the way that it works. He is fun to watch. It's weird in a world in which you have a guy, you know how much bullcrap I had to hear? Well, he doesn't have a weapon of a three-pointer. How can he be out there in this era? Yeah, I don't know everybody, but he damn sure makes it work. Well, he can't shoot the three. He can't pull up from 35 off a rebound off the defensive end in one pass. How can he possibly play? I'm telling you, he has meant so much. Where do you rank him as we celebrate TJ McConnell? Where do you rank him as far as level of importance? And I'm not saying just in general, but to this season. Rank TJ McConnell and his importance in relation to this season. Halliburton's obviously at the top. Is McConnell next? And when you think or you doubt, I don't know, Siakam hadn't been here long enough. Miles, you know, Mathurin when he was healthy and active. But then when you look at these games and then when you recall exactly the situations that went down and how necessary he was in those situations, it may change your tune. True story right there. All right, 239-1070 is the number. If you guys want to jump on, you certainly can. Denari, top of the hour. Talk about the Pacers' win over Toronto last night. And why we scoreboard watch later on tonight. And some of the scenarios that should interest Pacer fans here down the stretch. With Chris coming up here at 4. Terry's at 239-1070. Terry, welcome to the show. How are you, sir?
Hey, buddy. How you doing? Iowa State alum. How you doing, Adam?
I am outstanding. From one alum, I believe I'm an alum. I've always kind of questioned a little bit. I didn't go through graduation in 93. There was a hellaciously big party at Varsity Villas in Bloomington that weekend, and I skipped graduation. I believe my name was called, but I have no evidence of it. I just never have asked.
Understandable. As long as you're on the road, that's all that counts.
I will. I'm thinking. That's what the last thing, you know, it's kind of like when, if you've ever watched The Wolf of Wall Street or, you know, or any of these type of movies like Boiler Room, they teach you to get the answer you're looking for and then hang up. So when I got that answer, when my counselor in 93 said, yeah, you'll graduate, I left the room and never looked back.
Yeah, I was down there with you guys. I came out in 92. I was on that team with Eddie Bird and them, that down there with Coach Green.
Who am I talking to right now, Terry?
Terry Futch.
No, man, good to hear from you.
Yeah, but I was down there on that team. I know I heard you mention about Bethany yesterday, and nobody, I don't know if somebody said, that's Buffy he's talking about. I thought you talking about Buffy, yeah, but yeah.
Yes, yeah. I had no idea she was an animal activist around here. I think she was in like a history. I don't know why I was in there. The history of women in film. I was taking all these really difficult classes, right? The history of women in film.
The theater room over there.
Well, I think when I signed up for it, I thought it was going to be like porn or Skinamax or something, and it turned out I had to watch a lot of Meryl Streep movies, but it all worked out.
See, don't do that. But no, man, yeah, man, it's sad what's going on down in Iowa State, man, but I was telling people, you know, if you got a president and your AD and, you know, that guy, you know, is like, well, I'm in shambles. I got an offer. You know, it is what it is, but it's a mess. But I'm proud of them, man. They were really excited to watch and everything. And I said, it's better than our claim to fame. Back then, you know, our claim to fame, we got in that big scuffle with Sasha, with Wichita State, with Darren Lyles. That was our claim to fame.
I do. I absolutely I remember that a great deal. I had some great – I was talking to P.J. Thompson a couple of weeks ago, and his dad made a couple of appearances at some great parties, whether it was 606 South 5th or 6th and Deming or 8th and Crawford. He and Marcus Johnson both made appearances. It was big time. Stoyanovich, or what's his name? Mike Jovanovich. Jovanovich was always there.
Jovan, white chocolate, get up in the air. Jovan.
I think I may have had him arrested once accidentally. I think it was my fault.
I think Jovan's a state trooper now.
Is he? Well, I take it all back.
That's usually how it goes. The ones you wouldn't think be one, maybe a trooper, but I seen you at the Hinkle the other night, so I didn't want to, you know, bother you. I seen you.
No, you should have came by and talked, man. I'm always ready, willing, and able to talk. My point, Terry, regarding shirts and everybody in the transfer portal is I was trying to prepare everybody for that because I knew that's where it was going. And if you're Indiana State or anybody else, this is a moment to where you look at it, and if the rules are going to be like this, you can't put your head in your hands and weep. You've got to find a way out of it. It just starts now with the decision-making at the university here and with the administration, and we'll see what ends up happening.
I didn't realize that president was that bad until I came down for the alumni, the basketball alumni thing on February when they played Drake. And they were introducing Sherms as putting his retiring jersey, and they booed so loud they had to clear up. They wasn't booing him; they was booing her. And I didn't realize it was that bad until I was up in the suite, and one of the basketball players that graduated recently told me what was going on. I didn't know it was that bad. I was like, oh my God! So they was trying to clear up. They weren't, you know, booing Sherm; they was booing her because when they showed her on the screen, you know, trying to present him, that's what the crowd was booing about. I'm like, wow, what's going on?
Yeah, she was.
That's when I realized was that bad.
She was problematic, and you know, she created problems within the town itself too. Which, as you well know, the town and the university was trying to get back on the same plane because there had been a rub with both over the past couple of years, and they were kind of getting back to, you know, a nice relationship, and that was problematic. But I think this was after you. I knew John Moore, President John Moore, the late John Moore, was a tremendous guy and a great president. Yeah. He was a great guy.
Yeah, we had Mr. Landine.
Yeah, I remember that too. Yeah, I think John Moore came in the summer of '92, if memory serves. But he was fantastic. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, we'd be all right, man. Eventually, I guess we're fair. The only thing was, man, I was looking forward for this fall, man. We had a premier team and a casino opening up, man. That was a heck of a day trip.
Exactly. Exactly.
They messed that all up. Like, screw that. They was gonna make even more money. They got an attraction and a casino. That'd have been, man.
Well, Terry, call anytime. I love to talk Indiana State with you. You call anytime.
All right, man. Good show. Thanks, man. You guys take it easy.
You got that. Yeah, I think 92. Yeah, it normally is. And maybe I'm wrong about this. IU fans, you can chime in because you have gone through some presidents of the past that obviously you weren't thrilled with. But when you bring up the president of a university, like on a talk show like this, you know, a public forum, I mean, it's normally bad, right? How often do you bring, maybe you do, you bring somebody, everything's great. It seems like any time if there is anything going on as to the reason why you have to talk about a school's president, seems to me like 80% of the time it's going to be bad, going to be negative. Quick break. We shall return. Kristen Airy coming up at the top of the hour. TJ McConnell, sixth man of the year, most improved player, at least bench recognition from me. Pacers a winner last night. Did they get over that hump of playing down to their competition? We saw it in the first quarter, got down by 10, but then dominant in both the second and the third in that runaway win last night. Cleveland and Atlanta remain, and a lot of scoreboard watching. Kristen Airy, top of the hour. Don't go anywhere. It's 93.5, 107.5 The Fan.
I like to be active, and as you get older, I know it.
Sent you.
The Ride with JMV.
They call me Cuba Pete. I'm the king of a rumba beat. When I play the maracas, I go chick, chicky, boom, chick, chicky, boom.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Hey, James, is that another, what was that?
That's also from The Mask.
I don't think I like that either.
Really?
It's weird. I like Jim Carrey. I loved In Living Color. And the stuff that he did, like Liar Liar, was really good. Mm-hmm. I just don't like The Mask.
You've never seen The Mask, though, have you?
No. I just consider that I'm not going to like it. I don't like Ace Ventura, either one of those.
See, I don't like Ace Ventura either, but I love The Mask.
Cuban Pete. Yeah, I think Jim Carrey's incredibly talented. I really like him in, I believe, his second film called Once Bitten. 1985, little known classic.
I've never.
Once Bitten.
Never seen that.
And he didn't do that, like, Jim Carrey kind of rubber face stuff going on.
Was he playing it a little bit more straight?
Yeah, kind of was. Yeah. I think it was 85, Once Bitten right there. With Jim Carrey. Jim Carrey doing Vanilla Ice on In Living Color. I could watch that every single moment. It's so good. Hey, big news, at least so far today, in the transfer portal. Purdue 6'6 guard Ethan Morton has entered. All right, here's his career in a nutshell in 4 years at Purdue. And I know that Matt Painter liked him a great deal. And by the way, if you're asking about Matt Painter, I'm going to get him on. I'm going to wait. This is not something you go, hey, you know what? You guys just lost in the national championship game. You want to come on tomorrow? We'll give it a little bit of time. It's like when you get, I don't know if you do this any longer, right? If you're single and you go out and you get a girl's number, you kind of wait. There's a time frame in which you wait to call. You don't just, hey, call at midnight, like in Swingers. You don't pull that off, right?
You give it some time.
You give it a little bit of time. So when you have a game like Monday night, you give that a little bit of time, at least in that particular category. But 4 years, 132 games for Ethan Morton at Purdue. 25 minutes per game as a junior. That's down to 10 as a senior, and he was completely out of the rotation late in the season. Under a point a game, under a rebound a game, Ethan Morton is in the transfer portal right there. All right, quick break. We shall return. Chris Denari, I love when they gave the props to one T.J. McConnell. We'll go even more in depth with that and what Chris Denari and Quinn Buckner had talked about. The win last night and what to watch for later on tonight and the rest of the season beyond the final two regular season games the Pacers will be a part of. That's Chris Denari, Bally Sports Indiana, other side, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Heat and cool places where ductwork won't fit.
CX Indianapolis.
The Ride with JMV.
It's 106 miles to Chicago. We got a full tank of gas, half a pack of cigarettes. It's dark, and we're wearing sunglasses. Hit it.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
John Calipari arriving in Fayetteville. That's how I want to arrive someplace right there. That's a party. Bowen, his sports arousal weekend forthcoming with the Masters. We'll talk to Kev coming up in the 5 o'clock hour. Pat Benatar, Neil Giraldo tickets to give away too. Darius Rucker brings us back because our next guest is his biggest fan. On the Andy Moore Automotive Group hotline, he is the voice of the Pacers, Bally Sports Indiana. It was once again an early struggle in that first quarter, but the Hammer went down with 40 and 41 respectively in the second and third quarters last night, and they didn't look back against Toronto, a team that they needed to beat down, and they did. Chris Denary, who joins us now. Hey, before we start here, did you happen to see Darius Rucker in the crowd over the weekend with South Carolina and Iowa in that championship game?
I did. They must have cut away to him 15 times. I think every time there was a crowd shot, I think it was Darius Rucker.
I will say this, and I'm assuming you probably saw this too. I think Aaliyah Boston is really good. She's a really good player. But for such a young age, how comfortable she was on TV, and I know it's South Carolina in large part, which she should be, but I thought she was really good in that group.
Well, she's really good, and you think about, she just embodies everything you want on the floor, off the floor. I think back, to when I was doing the Fever. I did it for 18 years, and was around Tamika Catchings for so many of those years. I mean, that's the type of personality that Aaliyah Boston has, and that people gravitate to that. And, I thought she was really, really good. And, when you're a WNBA player, you work all summer, you play 40 games, but you've got the off season, and some of them choose not to play overseas. But, Aaliyah can do a great job on television, and that's what she did.
So, Chris Denary, Bally Sports Indiana, Pacers a winner over the Raptors last night. Cleveland on the road, and it looks like Donovan Mitchell's returning tonight, so I would expect him to be going on Friday, and then Atlanta at home to close out coming up on Sunday. And we've talked about this before, and I've brought this up to JJ. The final eight, to me, hugely important. And to this point right now, of the final eight, they have won five and lost one. We all wish they had that clunker back in Brooklyn last week. Alas, they don't, but closing strong is a priority, Chris. And it's a priority because obviously you want the best seeding situation possible. But all in all, you want to see them playing their best basketball. And we really hadn't seen that consistently as we saw earlier in the season. But I think at least here in these final eight, we're starting to see that, right? We have certainly seen that here recently.
Yeah, especially like you said, they've won five of six. That's what you want. I go back to right around Christmas. They were 500 at 14-14. They had two big road wins at Houston and Chicago, and they won 9 of 10. And that really got them into the position where they've been, anywhere from 6 above .500 to where they are right now, 12 above .500. But now, playing consistent basketball is what you're looking for. That's what Rick Carlisle's looking for. And I'll say this. I mean, some of these teams that you're playing, look at Milwaukee. They had a stretch at home where they lost to Washington, Memphis, and they lost to the same Toronto team last night with the same roster that the Pacers beat. So, sometimes those games can be very, very difficult. You've got to be in a good mindset. Rick Carlisle could sense from the start that mindset wasn't there. It wasn't not making shots, but it was the six turnovers they had in the first quarter last night. But once they found themselves, I've been listening to you, TJ McConnell, second unit, Toppin, Isaiah Jackson, they came in and sort of flipped the script. And then the starters came back in and got the lead at the half and then jumped on them early in that third quarter. And I think that's what you have to do against teams like that. And that's not what they did against Brooklyn. Remember, they got an early lead, but then allowed Brooklyn to get back into it. And then Brooklyn got a double-figure lead. You're sort of in a battle for your life. And so I thought last night in the third quarter, fourth quarter, they extended that lead to 17 or 18. It was very comfortable, and they were able to get the win.
Yeah, and that Brooklyn game that lost, there were so many 50-50s, especially late, that Brooklyn ended up getting and got second chance. And that's been part of the issue. If there has been a consistent issue with this team, the second chance points opportunity was a big deal that led to a Mikal Bridges three last week that may have been the difference. And the one thing that I didn't like late in that game, and I'm glad you brought it up, was allowing Dennis Schroeder to go basically without anybody stepping up to him and laying it up late, final 2 minutes like that. Because I want to see their defense and awareness be much better than it was then in the final two, because that is most of the time, especially in the postseason, the difference between winning and losing.
Well, you talked about second chance points. I think the number last night, the Pacers had 37. 37 yeah. Second chance points. And that means, to your point, you're getting those 50-50 balls on the offensive rebound. You're attacking the glass. I thought they did a really good job. And a number of those 37 points were threes, because they would get the ball, reverse the ball. The best three you can get is usually on an offensive rebound, because you've got the defense scrambling. And I thought the Pacers did a really good job at that last night, especially in the second half.
So Chris Denary's on the Andy Moore Automotive Group hotline. I want to get into T.J. McConnell conversation. I want to lead in with this. The interview at the half with J.J. on Bally last night was fantastic, when he asked what was the difference between the first and second quarters of that game as they went to the half. And T.J. said, we grew up. We decided to grow up. What did you think he meant by that? I thought it was perfect no matter what he meant, but I certainly thought it was pointed, had some inspiration behind it that really T.J. McConnell offers every single night on the floor coming off the bench.
Well, what he meant, it's having a professional mindset and having respect for your opponent, even though they've got Scotty Barnes out and Poeltl out and Boucher out and Quickley out. They've got still some talented players, R.J. Barrett. They've got guys that are playing for jobs. You saw Freeman Liberty score 14 points in the first quarter. He's a rookie out of DePaul on a two-way contract. He's trying to make a name for himself. And so these are all professional players who, as I just said, they went to Milwaukee last week and won. So it's having a professional mindset, making sure you respect who's on the other end. You can't just show up and play the game. And, you know, I think he said it, and I think Tyrese said it after the game. You know, we were asleep, and we needed a wake-up call. And clearly T.J. McConnell has been that wake-up call, even when the starters have started well. And honestly, John, more often than not in the last 11 or 12 games, I think the Pacers have had the lead 6, 7, 8 times. So they've done a pretty good job at the start. But T.J. is still that guy that comes in and takes you to another level. And he has been so consistent. I mean, his ability to score is unlike something we have seen in his career. I mean, every night right now, you can count on somewhere between 12 and 20 points for McConnell off the bench. And, you know, he has to be a candidate for sixth man. I agree with you. He probably isn't going to get the love that Naz Reid's going to get at Minnesota, or Norman Powell, Malik Monk from Sacramento. But there's no question that the Pacers would not be in the position they're in without the play of T.J. McConnell.
Should he be recognized in the category for most improved?
I mean, he definitely, you know, here's the thing is his stats, he's averaging a little over 10 points per game. Those are career bests. You know, he's been anywhere from 6 to 8 points. You know how people vote. They're going to look at somebody that right. averaged 8 last year and now is averaging 17. So from that standpoint, you know, from a stat line, you know, probably he doesn't have a good shot at that. But if you actually watch the games and see his value to the team, clearly he's helped the Pacers improve. I mean, they won 35 games last year. They've won 46 right now.
So Chris Denary on the Andy Moore Automotive Group hotline. And what's so hilarious, I'm sure you heard this too, I had to hear this all the time about how he needed to be traded at the beginning of the year because he was going to take away minutes from younger players and all that bull crap. And now everybody recognizes what we have recognized for a long time, and not everybody has. how an essential piece he is for this team. And, Chris, you bring up a great point. Basically, it had been, well, he keeps up the pace when Halliburton goes to the bench. That is Pacer basketball offensively right now. But it's more than that with him, right? It's scoring. They count on him to score. Without him, to me, this team is drastically different. And when you look in terms of the personnel on this squad, he ranks very high with Tyrese Halliburton at the top for the most important players among this group on this team. That's where I put him right now, because what he is giving to this team night in and night out that we see, but maybe the rest of the NBA outside of LeBron James does not.
Well, and you know, let's also talk about leadership. I mean, he's one of the most veteran players on this team. You know, he's only behind Miles Turner in longevity with the Pacers. He's one of the 30-somethings on this team. And he told me a couple of weeks ago, our Pacers weekly show on Saturday mornings, I visited with him, and he said, you know, when the Pacers traded Buddy Hield, I knew that I had to step up offensively. I needed to do more for this team. I needed to make up some of the scoring that we were going to lose when we lost Buddy Hield. And he definitely has done that. I mean, this isn't just a game here and a game there. John, I think it's like 18 of 20 games he's been in double figures, and he's had a number of 20-point games. He's had some 17-point games. He's highly efficient. He plays with the pace that the Pacers want to play. But I think, again, it's his leadership that is so important to this group as well.
Miles said the other night that he's one of one. And, Chris, we live in this era where if you can't be a threat and jack and hit a three at that guard position, you are looked down upon. And that's, to me, where he's one of one, because that's never mattered. I've never considered that mattering, and it sure as hell doesn't right now.
No, I mean, his ability to beat people off the dribble, his craftiness around the basket, and honestly, John, if you look, over the last 15-some games, he's taken like maybe 18 or 19 threes, and he's shooting nearly 50%. So when he needs to make one, just like last night, he took one and he made it. You know, that's something he really didn't focus on early in the year, but he's taking them more often now. But it's his ability to beat people off the dribble. And you can just see, you know, time after time, you know, I go back to the Orlando game, and I'm a big Gary Harris fan. But TJ was putting it on the deck and beating Gary to the rim, and you could just see, you know, Gary was like, how is this happening? But it's not just Gary. It's every night he does this off the bench. So he's just been, you know, he's done this his entire career with Indiana. But when you're winning at the level that the Pacers are winning and you're in position – hopefully to make the playoffs, there's more attention. And so we're all seeing what TJ can do on a nightly basis.
So Chris Denari, Bally Sports Indiana, the voice of the Pacers, off until Friday on the road against Cleveland. I mentioned Donovan Mitchell should be back, is going to be back later on tonight. So the expectation, I would guess, is he'll play coming up on Friday. That is a team directly in front of the Pacers. We know just to win for themselves. But we're scoreboard watching, too, and I want to ask you what games you're going to be dialed into later on tonight, maybe on Thursday. What scoreboards will you be watching leading up to Friday?
Well, you've got Miami tonight. Miami is at home against Dallas, and they hung on for an overtime win. Again, they're behind the Pacers. You'd like to see them lose tonight.
Agreed.
Because that would knock them out of I think it would knock them out of a chance possibly to get the six. It's really crazy, John, because you would think that if the Pacers would win on Friday night that they would be in, but because of Orlando falling back and you've lost the tiebreaker to them, there's some 3- and 4-way ties that are crazy. So the good news is the Pacers are in firm control. They don't need any help if they win both of their games. If they win both of their games, they could possibly be 5. There's a chance they could be 4. So I'll be watching that. what Philadelphia has, Memphis, Orlando has Milwaukee twice in the last 5 days of the season. So all of those games impact. But again, if you're the Pacers and you take care of business on Friday and Sunday, you will be in the playoffs.
Yeah, it is an exciting time. You got a matchup of preference, or do you dare suggest that on the public airwaves here? Uh-oh. Phone hang up. James did that. Actually, James did not. I'm just blaming him for the hell of it. I don't know if I'm going to be allowed to ask Chris this. I'm sure he'll sidestep it. I don't blame him. But if there is a matchup that he likes more than anything else going into the postseason, what might that be? Some things that are jumbled up, no doubt about that, especially in the East here. There's anything that maybe he would like to see over anything else. I think we got him back right here. Kevin Bowen in the 5 o'clock hour, 2 Pat Benatar tickets for you. The Everwise Amphitheater coming up in the summertime. We'll get those tickets to you in the 5 o'clock hour. Chris Denary rejoins right now. I don't know if it's because of the phrasing, the question I was asking here, but is there any matchup that you think you might have a preference to come this postseason for the Pacers? Anything stand out?
No, I have none. I mean, I just want to see this franchise back in the playoffs. You know, the last time it was, they were in the playoffs. They were in the play-in in 2021. They were in the playoffs in 1920, but that was in the bubble in Orlando. So the last time that we've actually had playoff basketball at Gainbridge Fieldhouse is the 2018-19 season. So I don't care who it is. You know, I think the Pacers have done a good job against all of those teams that they could potentially play. I just think for this franchise to get back in the postseason, I think that's going to be very important. And that's going to pay dividends, not just this year, John. And as you said, nothing is ever guaranteed. You've got to look at the now. But I think back to 2011 when the Pacers made the playoffs against the Bulls. Derrick Rose was the MVP. That really set the table for the next 3 years. And I think this is a franchise that is far ahead of schedule. I mean, 25 wins 2 years ago, 35 last year, 46 and counting right now. But I think this team could make some noise in the playoffs, and I'm looking forward to it. But, again, you got to take care of business. Big one on Friday against Cleveland, and then fan appreciation night on Sunday.
All right, Chris, Tyrese Halliburton had 30 last night, and especially here of late, it looks like he's becoming more of the Halliburton that basically the rest of the NBA nation discovered earlier this season. And I know he may be being tired, going through an injury situation, coming back from that. You know, a lot of things factor into it, but he looks like the early season, or he looks more and more like the early season Halliburton that we really loved going back to late November, early December.
Yeah, and I think that three-point shot really has been a huge factor, because then it creates all those opportunities you saw last night for him to put the ball on the floor and get to the basket, because you have to honor that three-point shot from so out, you know, so far out on the floor. And I think it's over the last 10 games or so, John, he's shooting 43-44% from three-point range. So that three-point shot has come back, and that just makes his game so different, because, again, you have to pay attention to so many different things: his ability to shoot the ball, his ability to drive, his ability to find his teammates. So it was only a matter of time. You know, all players go through, you know, an 82-game season. All players go through a point where they struggle. And it just so happened that Tyrese had the injury that also impacted that. But I think he looks great right now. I think the other thing is, you know, think back to the Friday game against Oklahoma City and then the Sunday game against Miami. He only had 12 and 8 points, yet the Pacers still won those two games. Last night, the Pacers needed his scoring, and he knows when he's needed in whatever he needs to do. And last night they needed his scoring, and he responded in the second half.
It also seems like, and it would stand to reason, that you see each game as we move further and further and approach, obviously, the postseason, that Pascal Siakam is in that position now where he's completely comfortable after that trade.
Yeah, he's played as many games with the Pacers now as he played in Toronto. And I'll tell you what, each and every night I watch this guy. I only watched him a handful of times each year when the Pacers would play Toronto, and maybe I'd catch them on League Pass. But, this guy just makes winning plays. I mean, he had 9 rebounds last night, a number of offensive rebounds. He's a guy you can win games with. And it does take time when you bring a player of that ilk into your locker room. But I think he's fit in very, very well. And I think that's what makes the Pacers a dangerous team in the postseason. I mean, you know, we don't know where they're going to end up seated. We sure hope it's in the playoffs and not have to go through the play-in round. But I can't imagine that if the Pacers have to face anybody that has a higher seed, that they'd be really enthused about playing Indiana because of the addition of Pascal Siakam.
I think it's also the pace, and we'll see what happens in the postseason, because notoriously, you know, the defense really, you know, ratcheted up, and we'll see, you know, how the Pacers respond offensively to that. But as I said all along, and you see this on a night in, night out basis, if they're able to maintain their style of play, their pace, and I thought against Miami on Sunday, we saw the difference in it. And it was a dominant first half, and then a second half where Miami played at the pace where Miami wanted to play, and the Pacers hung on, ended up winning that. But I think you saw in one game the difference in how you want to see the Pacers play offensively and how other teams like Miami want to see them play with their defense.
And I think the way that game on Sunday ended up, and some people would say, hey, you had a 22-point lead, you only won by 2. I think that was really helpful for the Pacers, because they had gone through a stretch, John, where they had lost 6 straight and 7 of 8 games in clutch, and 4 of those were at home. So they sort of needed a game that was close that they could look back on and say, hey, we made these plays down the stretch. We made free throws. So I think the way that game ended up really is going to be a benefit for the Pacers moving forward.
Chris Denari with us. Before I let you go, we kind of started with the Fever and what is forthcoming. But today, you know, we got the schedule release, and 36 of the 40 Fever games are going to be televised nationally with a variety of stations, including ABC and ESPN and CBS and others. And you have, you know, before she even gets here yet, and she's drafted, the Caitlin Clark effect. I know you probably can't get into that, but it is amazing the effect that is going down right now with the ticket sales and nationwide what people want to see and how they're positioning themselves television-wise to see it.
Yeah, no question. And I would suppose that at some point you will see some type of a local package as they've had in the past. And a lot of times those NBA TV games, while they are distributed nationally, those are a part of a local package. So, we'll wait and see that. But, you know, I got my start with Pacer Sports and Entertainment with the Indiana Fever all the way back in 2000. I was the first radio and TV voice of the Fever, and I did it for 18 years, and now Pat Boylan does it. So I have such great memories of watching this franchise be built by Kelly Kroskoff from the ground floor. And the fact that Herb Simon and the Pacers management stuck with it, getting to the WNBA Finals in 2009, finally winning a championship with Catchings in 12, getting back to the finals in 15, and there have been some lean years, but with Aaliyah Boston, with what they are going to do on Monday night with the number one pick, and as you said, with all of this exposure they're going to have, I mean, it's a great time to be with Pacer Sports and Entertainment. What the Pacers are doing, the renovation of the field house, Bicentennial Unity Plaza, and, I hope we have a May that is very busy every night, where you've got a Pacers playoff game and a Fever game. I mean, and then you have the month of May. Is there anything better, John, than the month of May with Pacers and Racers, and let's throw some Indiana Fever games in there? I mean, that's going to be spectacular.
You know me. I'm ready to win and win right now. I got so sick and tired of hearing about the future and draft capital long term. It's like beating me down. So, yes, I'm ready for winning in the postseason of any kind. Any ride that wants to be given, I'm ready to go here.
Well, and I think we got off to a good start, right? I mean, unfortunately, our two teams lost in the finals, Indiana State and the NIT, Purdue in the national championship game. But look at it. We had two teams, you know, playing for championships. And then I'll say from a Division III standpoint, Trine up in Northwest Indiana, they won the Division III national championship. So it's been a good year, great year for basketball, all the great high school stuff that's going on. So, hey, let's have it continue with the Pacers. Let's have it continue with the Fever. You know, I'm really looking forward to it.
I'm going to live in the moment. Yeah. I like to live in the moment, too, because you saw what happened to my Sycamores. It's just all crumbled.
You have to live in the moment. Look at what happened last night for Milwaukee. We do not know the extent of Giannis's injury. I mean, you have to live in the moment because you never know what's on the other side of the door.
That is a hell of a point right there. I did want to bring this up before I let you go, Chris. Herb Simon is going into the Naismith Hall of Fame. That was announced over the weekend out in Arizona at the Final Four. And it has been a special relationship with the family, the Simon family, certainly, and Herb, and this community since 1983. And you see now, you know, the celebration, the honoring of that.
Yeah, we would not be talking about what we just spent 5 minutes talking about, the Fever. We would not be talking about the Pacers, Gainbridge Fieldhouse, if it wasn't for Herb and Mel and what they did 40-plus years ago. So, you know, I saw the quote that Adam Silver had. You know, he's the longest-tenured governor in the NBA. I think he might be the longest-tenured owner governor in all of professional sports, you know, when you think about it. You know, I know the McCaskey family with the Bears and those types of things, but just a great man. And, you know, he hires great people and he lets great people do their work. So fantastic that, you know, Herb is going into the Naismith Hall of Fame, and we'll look forward to that banner hanging in Gainbridge Fieldhouse with all the other Hall of Famers.
Man, I try to think about what could have happened a couple of different times. You bring it up. In terms of the Pacers, yeah, we brought it up before. In terms of the Colts, I'd be detasseling corn had any of those things gone haywire.
Yeah, I mean, it's when you think about what sports has meant to Indianapolis, the professional teams with the Pacers, the Colts wouldn't be here without the Pacers. With all the Final Fours, the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. I mean, we are very, very lucky, and sometimes we take it for granted. I mean, I'm on the road. You know, 2 months out of the year visiting other cities, and, you know, they all ask me about Indiana and this and that and the Speedway and the Colts and the Pacers. And, you know, we're very, very lucky for, you know, what we get to cover, what you get to talk about on a daily basis.
Chris Denary's got you Friday, a couple of days off, and then the first of the final two in the regular season, Friday on the road in Cleveland. And then Sunday, Fan Appreciation Day, and Atlanta in town. You just win. I mentioned momentum is real. It builds confidence, and confidence sustained builds winning. So that's what I wanted to see out of these final eight. And so far, they've only whiffed on one of those. That's a good thing, even beyond the seeding to me.
Absolutely. I mean, if you can win these final two and in your eight go 7-1, I think the Pacers would take that going away easily.
All right, go get them. Tell everybody I said hello. We'll check back in, I'm sure, here once we know exactly what's happening in the postseason, Chris.
All right, thanks, John.
Chris Denary, Valley Sports Indiana. The play-by-play voice on the Andy Moore Automotive Group hotline. Are we getting geared up here? I know. Because of some of these letdown games. And you know, the example was that first quarter last night. That has been a bit of a turnoff to some. But are we ready to get this thing into gear? Yeah, he mentioned the last time in the field house there was a postseason game. I'm ready to get this thing fire. Anybody else? I want to win. And I respect everybody. He mentioned trying and... You know, he brought up Indiana. It was fun, but there's a huge but now. Hey, it was really fun, but You know, Purdue, it was really fun and yet, but I want to see some winning without a butt. Buttless winning. That's what I want to see. Man, I think everybody around here, I think you as the fans, you deserve it. I'm curious how on board you are as we get close to the start of the postseason. Masters weekend, and Bowen is walking around jousting at will with his sports arousal. He's really excited about this weekend because he loves the Masters, he loves golf, and he can break it down. I am for, who's that kid's name again from South Knox?
Adam Schenck.
Adam Schenck?
Yeah.
I'm for Adam Schenck. Now, Adam's going to say, please, for the love of God, pick somebody else, because about 5 years you picked Brant Snedeker, and I have no idea what Brant Snedeker's even doing now. Please pick somebody else. Talk to Kev about that, a variety of other things, too. Also, getting in gear regarding the Colts and the draft coming up at the end of this month, too. Kev, top of the hour, Pat Benatar, Neil Giraldo tickets to give away, too. Hey, stay right there inside the AAA Membership Lounge via YouTube Live at 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You know, many people my age who went to college.
What for?
He's got a knife.
That's not a knife. That's a knife.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
All right, so I was watching early this morning after I got up at 5:35. Live and Let Die. What I think is a great James Bond film. A lot of you don't like Roger Moore. Roger Moore's my favorite. 1973, Live and Let Die. And it always begs the question, and I'm just going from the standpoint of Roger Moore. I know everybody loves Sean Connery, and hell, I don't even know who does it now. Who does it now? Daniel Craig? Who's the guy that's Bond now?
Well, there isn't a Bond now. Daniel Craig was the most recent one.
Most recent.
He just finished.
All right, so, anyway, I dug on Roger Moore, and I always thought, you know, if you really want to stick a fork in 007, how about just doing it? You always got to come up with this elaborate way to see him die. I mean, when you could just, like, off him right there in front of you. Y'all are carrying guns, I guess. But instead, you got to put him over a shark tank and cut his forearm so it drips blood and attracts sharks. And you got to go through this really long diatribe of words to tell him how he's about ready to die. And then ultimately, he has so much time because you're yapping about it, he's able to escape. Or you drop him off in the middle of an alligator pit. Hit him with your cars. I don't know anything. Run him over with a tractor. Throw him out of the back of your pickup truck. Anything. It's just all of this. It's always some long, elaborate process where you also have to make a Tom Cruise-esque film speech about it and then ultimately escapes. I love it, though. Hey, by the way, that's the Jane Seymour one. And Jane Seymour is about 80 years old right now and still state-of-the-art. Impressive. Kristen Neri, podcast 1075thefan.com, where you can also hear our conversations regarding the Boilermakers yesterday and going back to Monday, the Eclipse 2024 play-by-play, as Jake Query did the play-by-play, and I was the color analyst of an Eclipse, I think, that turned out with everybody, right? Even if you were skeptical, a little bit like me, and go, yeah, whatever, the Eclipse. Even if you're skeptical like me, it was pretty damn cool. 1075thefan.com. If you're asking regarding Matt Painter, I will get him on. I'm going to let Monday night get a little bit of time to breathe, if that's okay with you. But I do want to talk to him about this season and about the Final Four and all that. And hear what he has to say. Ethan Morton, by the way, has entered the transfer portal. If you missed that, the Boilermaker, who's got one more year remaining, what, a graduate year, I think. Ethan Morton is in the transfer portal. And as of yesterday, as you well know, I had no idea that there were like 9 dudes on the Indiana State team. But everybody but Sycamore Sam is in the transfer portal. So I'm going to have to double back. I still got my jersey. I'm going to put my jersey on and see if I can get some of the guys that hung out with me over there. Maybe I can get my intramural team back. I'll get Scompy and everybody on my intramural team, and we'll have to run that back, I guess. That is where they are. And the transfer portal is popping. John Calipari, his entrance to Fayetteville as the new head coach of the Razorbacks was pretty classic. I mean, hell, they had a brass band playing and everything. You, like, walk in. It's a pretty damn big deal in Fayetteville, Arkansas. And then earlier today regarding Kentucky, I know you guys don't care about it too much. Scott Drew was supposed to be on the plane there, and then he took a picture of himself and a booster eating at a diner in Waco. It's just great. It's college basketball. We love you. I don't know if we love it just because we love basketball. That has to be it, because it is so blanked up otherwise. It is so stupid. The whole thing is stupid, but I love basketball so much, you can't take me away. It's so stupid. All of it. Dumb. Yet here I keep on coming down. I tried to tell Doyle yesterday that I'm a part of the problem. I'm the issue. Maybe if I just go away for a minute You take out somebody that loves the game so much, and, yeah, you know what? I'm fed up. I'm done. And if we all did that, maybe something would happen. But I cannot. I've got to watch. So I'm part of the issue. Jeremiah is at 239-1070. Part of the issue with you right now. Hello, Jeremiah.
Hey, JMV. Thanks for taking the call.
You got it, buddy.
Hey, I'm more of a Pierce Brosnan 007 fan, kind of my era.
I'm probably Roger Moore more than anything else. I kind of fall off, like the second half of Moonraker is a bummer. Once they leave Rio, I got to turn it off because all that space crap, it wears me out. Yeah. But I do love this. There's always a theme of the era. Like in 73, when Live and Let Die was made, you know, you had the black exploitation films that were going down. So they were playing off of that angle. And in 77 was The Spy Who Loved Me, you know, 2 years later than Jaws, and there was all shark and underwater stuff happening. And then Moonraker, after Star Wars in 77, Moonraker was made in 79 and, you know, was all about outer space as you went deeper. So there's always some kind of theme, but... Yeah, when I was young and enjoyed it, and because I love Barbara Bach a great deal still to this day, I think Roger Moore is always going to be my favorite.
Yeah, but Pierce Brosnan had Halle Berry,
get away. I don't know if it's just me at seven seeing just Cleve bouncing all over the screen everywhere in Italy or on the island on Sicily. I don't know if that's what got me. I don't know if I think that Ringo Starr is one of the luckiest dudes of all time in real life. I cannot get away from Barbara Bach. I can't.
Yeah, I can see that for sure. The other thing is T.J. McConnell. I think I'm going to have to go with he's actually probably the most. Halliburton, I give him a lot of respect. But like you were saying earlier, when things are going awry and they bring the sixth man off, and it's McConnell, he gets the crowd going way more than anyone else of the starters, in my opinion. His hustle is just off the charts. Like, if you could stat a hustle, the guy would be number one.
He is second or third most essential on that team. You could make an argument that he's second right behind Tyrese Halliburton as being essential, an essential player. But
you got to look at his defense, too. I mean, you hear Quinn every time – once he gets a steal on the inbound pass, there we got a McConnell. You know, that's a lively a group when he's out there on the floor, even if it's not the sixth man with, you know, his few starts that he's had. It's just a different vibe I get, you know, and it's consistent. The guy may not hit the three, but he's driving the lane. He's going up against the bigs as being a small guy himself. That's phenomenal to see his tenacity, I think, is just off the charts. I don't think you see a lot of that in the NBA, and his willingness just to defend anybody and get into their, you know, they had a player like that with Lance. He would get into the mindset of some of those guys. I think McConnell does it with a little less flash and pizzazz, but he has that ability to just shut down some of those guys that are, you know, all-star caliber, and I would never want to see the Pacers trade him by any means whatsoever. So I think that's one of those that he's definitely a valuable asset. I hope he gets the sixth man award, but I don't see it happening. And I'm also astonished that you're not a fan of Ace Ventura: Pet Detective.
No, I hate it.
It's a sports and a comedy together.
No, I just think it sucks. Whenever they say Laces Out, I just get sick because I think that movie sucks so bad. Yeah.
Yep, I understand.
Hey, tell Melissa I said hello.
Will do. I appreciate it, my brother.
There you go. I'd agree. And Greg brings up this point. I completely agree. I brought this up earlier. Remember once upon a time, Pacer nerds, the dorks out there, you know, the draft assets, and they got to get younger players in, and the hatred of Miles and all your crap, wanted to trade Turner and McConnell, which would stand to reason. If I were you, I would erase all evidence of you ever. And I know most of you are incredibly anonymous wussies anyway, but I would erase all evidence of you saying something so incredibly stupid that it still has a heartbeat 6 months later and people can go, my God, you're an idiot. So since you're anonymous because you're so worried about somebody finding out who you are because you can't jack with people anymore, I guess you can go ahead and leave it up. Man, how stupid was that thought? Hey, by the way, Ethan Morton into the transfer portal. Mason Gillis of Purdue now into the transfer portal. So Morton and Gillis into the transfer portal from the Purdue Boilermakers. Quick one, we'll come back. Kevin Bowen, top of the hour. Adam Shank is who I'm going with. It's the first time I've ever picked a golfer from high school or from South Knox High School in the Masters. Very excited about it. Let's take a quick break. We'll come back. 93.5 107.5 The Fan.
If you're unaware, T-Mobile calls them.
Any special message for all the kids watching at home?
Stay out of trouble.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Ethan Morton and Mason Gillis in the transfer portal. Kristen Airy a little bit earlier on the podcast, 107.5thefan.com. Pacers a winner last night. Two remaining in the regular season. Friday at Cleveland. We'll watch the Cavs later on tonight. Donovan Mitchell is expected back, so the expectation is that he participates coming up on Friday. Friday, Cleveland on the road, and then Sunday, Fan Appreciation Day with the Hawks. Win them both, get that momentum, and then hopefully somebody else screws up around you and you can take full advantage of it. That's what you're hoping for. And the Indiana Fever schedule announced, obviously, before the WNBA draft next week, which is a hell of a deal. 36 of 40 nationally televised for the Fever coming up this year. I think they had 18 in a similar capacity a year ago. One on ABC or ESPN. But I think 18 in a similar capacity a year ago. Big deal it is. 239-1070. And Keith, line three, is going to join us before the top of the hour. Hello, Keith.
JMV.
Keith.
I just want to run a quick little scenario. So, All-Star break, I threw down a $100 bet on the Pacers to win division. It pays $8,000. Thought it was a good bet at the time because they had 2-0 against the Cavs. They'd worked the Bucks. But they were hovering around 6.5. So all of a sudden in the last week, they're offering me $300 to cash out going into the last night's games. And then after the Bucks won, they're offering me $400 now. Think I should take $400 or you think I should ride it out for the $8,000?
You have to have a lot of help still in this. Man, this is tough. I would almost take it right now and go because you have to hope for so much. What are you thinking?
Well, sticking with it, I just won. So,
how much did you lay down again?
$100. Big bet for me.
Yeah. Yeah, man. I guess no guts, no glory right here. I mean, you're going. I give you credit. You're pulling up to this thing with your fellows in a wheelbarrow, and I've got mine in a thimble right now with my answer. So, well, yeah, take the money. Go ahead. Take it and put it in an IRA.
Why did they increase the payout? Is Giannis, is he out now?
Well, I think, he injured his calf last night. Nobody knows exactly what's going on, but Pacers 2.5 back. Cleveland has been struggling. Cleveland's a little bit different because the Pacers can get them on Friday, but Cleveland is back to full strength now. Donovan Mitchell is coming back tonight, but I think it has to do with the uncertainty of the Giannis injury for real. So they're trying to get out of paying you $8,000. So maybe that's the reason why you stick with it.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, well, I mean, like you said a couple weeks ago, you thought the Pacers were going to run the table to finish after that road trip, right?
I did. So, you believe I just took the $400? God, I suck.
Well,
no one. I'm such a bad decision maker financially. Yeah. No wonder. But no, hey, write it until it bucks you here. That's a 10-cup reference and no guts, no glory. Hey, if you feel it, deal it. Just go with it right here. Go with it and report back. And if we win $8,000, we'll head down to Greensburg or go to Frisch's Big Boy, and you can buy.
Heck yeah, man.
All right, brother. Keith, I appreciate it. Keep us updated. You believe me, I have zero guts. Where are my fellas? I'm going to find my fellas. My fellas are missing. I think you should go ahead and take the $400. That's what I would do. God, whose dad do I sound like right there? Hell, I didn't even have a dad, and I sound like somebody's dad. Weird. I think you should take the $400. We should put that in the bank. Put it in for college. Yeah, and then I go out there and pay $4.99 a box for crackers. What the hell am I doing? Bad decision maker. Bowen's next.
We all hear the radio ads about the IRS.
Indianapolis. The Ride with JMV.
I am the cream, yeah. The cream of the crop. And there is no one that does it better.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Crank it up, James. This is for Bowen right here. And he can't hide it. He's about to lose control. And he thinks he likes it. You got the Jesse Spano version of this from Saved by the Bell?
I can look it up.
No, look it up. I think if we're going to bring on Kevin Bowen from the morning show with Sweebo, 7 until 10 a.m., weekday mornings here on The Fan, because he is so incredibly excited, sports aroused over the beginning of the Masters tomorrow. If we have the Pointer Sisters, and I'm so excited, I think we need to have Jesse Spano. And the Spano version of I'm So Excited is James Searches Kevin Bowen of Sweebo in the mornings on the Andy Moore Automotive Group hotline. Are you jousting folks over there near Broad Ripple with your level of excitement for this weekend?
Yeah, I don't know if I'd use the word joust, but some combination of Indiana State winning it all, the Reds in the World Series, DJ McConnell, Sixth Man of the Year, Miles Turner, all NBA. You kind of just make that magic potion for your sports arousal. That's currently me here on this Christmas Eve for myself.
Kevin Bowen has a sports pup tent going into this weekend.
A lot of blue pills right now is how I'm feeling on this Wednesday.
I say all this because I want to have some like kids riding around with their parents right now and have to ask their parents what we're talking about. I do. That's my hope.
Well, yeah, I would assume 5 o'clock. You probably have some, I don't know, daycare or sport cancellations maybe occurring given the weather outside. So,
hey, Dad, what are they talking about? What is this pup tent thing they're talking about, Dad? What is that?
Yeah. Arousal sounds like maybe like an SAT word for like a seventh grader or something like that. So.
It is beautiful. Hey, you guys had what's his name on from South Knox? Adam Shank? Right? South
Adam
Knox?
Shank grew up on a sod farm, absolute legend.
God, I love a sod farm.
Adam Shank. Hits it a long way. Hits a draw, which is always a nice thing at Augusta National. First ever Masters. Yeah, diehard Purdue fan. We had him on last week. Played great down in San Antonio. Best finish on the tour this year. So fun story, and hope he plays well in his Masters debut.
Should I pick him?
Of course.
You think if I pick him and if I pick him and he wins, do you think that he would be so enthused that I picked him and would give me some sod? I would take some sod.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
What do they sod? Did he tell you what they sodded? They just sod yards and things like that. They take him to like home builders. That's the sod.
Yeah, I would assume. And then he plays down at what's that great course in Newburgh, Victoria National?
Oh yeah, that's a big time. That's big time.
Yeah, that's the real deal. That's the hardest course in the state by far, Victoria National. So, yeah, I don't know the intricacies of the sod, but you know we had him on last Wednesday, and he was trying to decide if he could get from Phoenix to Augusta, and make it work to watch his Boilers on Monday night. I texted him after he finished. I think it was fourth or fifth on Sunday. I was like, you're going to be able to make it work. Unfortunately, not able to make it work, but he definitely sounds pretty eager to play in his first Master. So he's really had a hell of a professional career. I mean, he's a very good player at Purdue, but yeah. I think he'd be the first one to tell you he didn't think this was in store. I mean, he finished like ninth or 10th on the PGA Tour last year, ninth or 10th in the Tour Championship. So fun story, and hope he plays really well this week.
See, here's one of the reasons why I'm hesitant, because I want him to do well, and I'm normally the kiss of death, and I don't even know where this dude is right now. But there was a five-year period where in every major, because he was really good on this show once upon a time, I picked Brant Snedeker. And I don't even know where the hell he is. I think he was at Vanderbilt from Nashville. Sure. I don't know. I don't think he's in the Masters. I don't even know if he plays golf anymore. I think I may have, with my selections, run him out of his career.
Yeah, somewhere Ed Carpenter's in his car right now saying, don't pick Adam Shank, right?
No doubt. Ed Carpenter said, I asked you not to pick me 2 years in a row now, numbnuts. Would you stop?
Yeah. pole vault practice at Cathedral just got canceled for Ed's daughter, and so he has picked, you know, he's got her in the car right now and is saying, Adam Shank, this is the last thing you want here. So, yeah, you know, some people are in these, you know, pools where there's, you know, multiple groups involved. You know, you pick a player from group one or two or three. You know, Shank, given his lack of Masters experience, he's probably in group three of many of these. So I honestly think he'd be a nice pick. Hits it a long way. A great ball striker. He'd probably tell you his putting might be the one spot he needs to improve on. But I think you look at the analytics of it lately, great putters necessarily haven't been necessary at Augusta National. So, sure, why not? Believe in the sod farm.
All right, so who are you picking?
I've got Tiger.
Oh, okay. All right.
And then if for some reason Tiger can't get it done, which he got a horrible draw by the Green Jackets, I cannot believe they gave him afternoon morning here coming up tomorrow and Friday. No recovery time for him. Granted, it sounds like he's put the extracurricular activities on hold for the week. If you see some of the reports out there. If not Tiger, I'm going to go Jordan Spieth.
All right, I'm going to stick with the kid. I've never picked in the Masters a kid that graduated from South Knox, so I'm excited about that.
Well, I'm going to go out on a limb and say you might be the first South Knox product to
I'm
play
very,
in the Masters.
Very excited about that, too.
Can
yeah,
you
I
imagine
saw...
if you compared like all the high schools of the people in the Masters and like where South Knox would rank on, you know,
yeah,
the glitz and the glamour of the country club high school. You know, Justin Thomas went to St. X Louisville. You know, Jordan Spieth probably went to some, you know, private school in Dallas. And good old South Knox, which is what I love about Adam Shank. He is a very down-to-earth individual.
Did Jeff Overton ever play in the Masters?
Oh, sure.
Did he?
Yeah, I mean, if he played in a Ryder Cup, he's got to be, he had to have played in the Masters, right?
I don't know. That's why I'm asking the expert here.
Yeah, I would say the year he played in the Ryder Cup, he would have had to play in the Masters right after that. I think typically that's how they operate it. So what was that, Evansville North?
Yeah, I wonder if he got drunk in an RV with Clayton Anderson the night before his first round.
Are you saying that might have happened before the Kentucky game?
No, I think they were kind of treating maybe a couple of moments like it was Tin Cup. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, going to Waffle House, staying in an RV, getting drunk, all that. So, yeah.
Jeff has never said no to a party, and he is making a comeback.
He is.
In all seriousness, yeah, he had like a life-threatening staph infection, if
Yuck.
I have that correct. I'm pretty sure that's accurate. And so, he's back healthy and got some medical exemptions on the PGA Tour, and don't think he's done great with any of them, but at least he's able to make, you know, probably one last run at it.
Good for Jeff. That's good news mm-hmm. right there. Good for him.
He would roll up the Kilroy. I mean, he'd have the limo on a Tuesday night when I was in college, rolling up there to Kilroy. I mean, it was unbelievable.
And the chicks in Bloomington, the IU chicks, would swoon if you rolled up to Kilroy's in a limo right there. So that's a hell of a play by him.
Yeah, no. I mean, that's like taking a dog to a tailgate.
I got an update for you. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Our mutual friend Eddie White says both Bo Van Pelt from Richmond and Jeff Overton have indeed played in past Masters. True story.
Shout
out to Eddie.
Eduardo Blanco for that. I was at the 2011 Masters. 2011 or 10? One of them. Charles Schwartzel ended up winning it, but Bo Van Pelt played great. If I'm not mistaken, that was the Masters where 9 or 10 different individuals had a lead on Sunday, and I think Bo Van Pelt at one point was one of them. So shout out to Richmond, shout out to Oklahoma State, and Bo Van Pelt.
You treat golf like I treat Skinamax, don't you? You know a little bit of everything about it.
Yeah. Right, yeah. Yeah, very, very two different pleasures there.
Oh, and remind Kevin that I did play the course, says Eddie right here. I'm sure he's jealous. I'm assuming you've never played. Yet. Eddie White has played and you haven't. What? No invite or anything for you, huh?
No. I mean, I'm not even close. I mean, let's be honest. Yeah. I would – part of me thinks I'd like to hear the story from Eddie, but then that could be another you know, you'd be going until 6:45 tonight.
Hey, Kev, did you ever play at the Bloomington Par 3 Lower Cascade with the lights? Did you ever play there when you were at IU?
Is that Taylor's?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
God,
oh, yeah.
I love that place.
Certainly.
I love that place. I haven't played there.
I think it's still intact.
It is, yeah. You ever play at night because they had lights, obviously, and then because it's the lower Cascade area right there where the fog would come in and you would hit your ball into the fog, it would disappear and then come back down somewhere?
Ooh.
You've never played on a foggy night at a lower Cascade at Taylor's?
I tried. This probably would have been – I also played Cascade, which had 27 holes for a while. I don't know if it still does. You know, Riverside, you know, right up there off whatever it is, 38th or 30th, that has lights. And I mean, probably a handful of years ago, I just assumed you could play there at night. And, and I call over there at probably like this time on a Friday night. I'm like, hey, you know, so my buddies were thinking, hey, let's go, you know, take a six pack out there, play the par three. And they're like, yeah, we haven't turned those lights on in 10 years. I was like, well, there goes that idea. So that would be a great – well, I mean, I guess it'd only be a handful of months out of the year, but that'd be really cool if we had that functioning here in Indianapolis.
No, I love that there too. Once upon a time, I lost – in 1987, I was 17, and I lost a bet. I lost a round at Bloomington Par 3, and I had to go to Claire's in the Bloomington College Ball and get my ear pierced.
That's the most South Knox thing I've ever heard you say.
Yeah, I go. And I roll home, and my mom, what is that? And then the basketball coach, what is it? Because this was like, you were really a rebel. Now it doesn't matter. It's nothing, right? It's like tattooing up now. But back then, you got your ear pierced, and, man, you were a rebel, especially where I was from. And I roll into school that day, and everybody – I had to run laps because – I got my ear pierced, like stair laps, because of it.
That is outstanding. Now, we could talk golf for the entire segment. You know me.
Yeah.
The new IU golf course is, you want to talk about hard, it might be Victoria National hard. That is the old golf course was glorified cross-country course. Every hole was virtually the same. The new one is no joke. Ned Fowle, you know the
Ned
man.
Ned Fowle's one of the greatest guys of all time. You've heard of that, right?
Yeah.
One of the greatest dudes of all time with deep pockets. I need to know him.
Yeah.
I need to talk to him.
Yeah. Yeah, they're a Floyd Knobs family, right?
Yes, they are.
Somebody down in Floyd Knobs.
Finally, we get somebody from that deep in southern Indiana that knows something, right, Sweebo?
He looked at me today. He goes, how in the world did I catch a stray from JMV last? Oh, were you calling me out for my Tiger pick? Was that what it was?
Yeah, I was just messing. I had finished playing basketball at about 11 o'clock last night at CG, and I got home. I sent it out about 11:30 or so. And I was always thinking of a way to compare him, if you've ever seen Fast Times at Ridgemont High, to compare Sweebo, Andy Sweeney, to the manager at Captain Hook's Fish and Chips, because they have a red beard similarity. And then I thought, man, I like what Kevin said about Tiger Woods, so I'm going to send this out. And then I felt bad about it because Pineapple Nick called in during Anything Goes and mentioned that he wanted to throw him out a window earlier in the day. And I thought, well, there's no connection or relation here. I wish now I hadn't sent it, because it kind of seemed like it was planned and it wasn't.
Yeah, I
Pineapple Nick got loose on him during Anything Goes yesterday.
Well, I think I've been a victim of that prior as well. So Andy and I can share in the mutual nature of that.
but I hope that he thought that was a joke and nothing more right there. But I wanted to compare him to the manager at Captain Hook's Fish and Chips and Fast Times at Ridgemont High because of their red beard similarities.
So do you have a pick? Is it Shank?
I'm going to have to go. I got to go with South Knox all the way here. Yes.
I love it.
Adam
Shank.
Should I pick a safety though too? Like, should I take John Rahm just because it's like one of the handful of dudes that I know? I don't really want to take John Rahm because Ted Bishop's going to come on tomorrow and probably rip all the live guys, and he's one of them. So should I take a PGA guy?
Yeah, let's go. I mean, do you want to see the feel good? Do you want to see Rory get the fourth major?
Yeah, but he's not gonna. Like, I need to take. I need to take somebody like Adam from South Knox and Southwestern Indiana, and then I need to take somebody that's a little bit more. I don't think Rory's even close to a sure thing, is he?
Well, I mean, it's Scottie Scheffler is the only thing that's going to sniff sure thing. If you look at the betting odds, Tony Finau do anything for you?
Yes, Tony Finau. What do you think? You want to give me that? I'll take that.
Yeah, Finau's had some great finishes at them. He was in the final round, or he was in the final group with Tiger in 2019. So,
all right.
Yeah, he bombs it all over the place. Started to play a little bit better a few weeks ago. Yeah, let's go Finau and Shank for JMV's card.
I like that. Thank you, Kevin Bowen, right there, helping me out with his master sports arousal on the Andy Moore Automotive Group hotline right there. Is Shank the only person from the state of Indiana in it?
Yeah, I don't. Patrick Rogers, Tyler Duncan, I think, just missed it.
Darn it.
But yeah, I mean, it is, again, we can continue to nerd out over it. It's kind of crazy that you have got like three of the top 100 players in professional golf are from Indiana. I mean, like, to me, that's just kind of like three dudes I played in the state finals with are top. Yeah, again.
You were in the state finals of golf? I didn't know that.
Top 125. Yeah. So, yeah, but, shout out. 2008 state finals, Adam Shank, Tyler Duncan, Patrick Rogers. Patrick Rogers is a freshman. I think got fifth. Tyler Duncan won it as a junior, shot 63 from Columbus North.
And you were in that too?
Yes. Ted Bishop handed out the hardware.
What did you finish?
Me personally, very far down the leaderboard, but thanks to some great teammates, we were able to capture the individual title.
Where'd you finish? Individually, where'd you finish?
Ooh, I was probably in the 50s.
That's awesome, though. Yeah. Good for you. What medal is that? Is that like in the 50s? Is there like a designation? Gold, what? Silver, bronze?
Yeah, you need one of those crayon boxes.
Play-Doh.
Colors, probably, too.
No, that's awesome, probably. Though. Good for you. I didn't know you were a top 60 guy in 2008. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that.
Cathedral High School state champs, Corey Zadonis.
Man, you're young.
Yeah. But Duncan was my age. Shank was 2 years younger, and Rogers was 3 years younger. So, Rosie, sorry, we got Rosie Bone in the background.
What's she doing?
No, she's currently putting on chapstick. Rosie, you got a pick for the Masters? You want Tiger or Adam Shank? Probably not the best thing for Rosie to be cheering for Tiger.
Aw. How old's Rosie now?
Rosie will be 4 in June.
That's incredible. So she's going to start. Well, she's already obviously in preschool, but she gets kindergarten for real coming up.
We are nearing it. You ask her, she could go tomorrow. So
that's awesome.
Gotta keep that in check here. I'm looking at these odds. Scottie Scheffler's plus 400. That is insane. That's like Tiger in his prime. You take one player of the field. That's crazy that he's that close to even money.
I'm just thinking about the incredible influence your wife, Maddie, has been on the family.
Well, yeah, she certainly birthed a couple children here, so without her,
So Kevin Bowen, the morning wake-up call, 7 until 10 a.m. here on The Fan. So Mason Gillis, Ethan Morton into the transfer portal. They're both going to graduate anyway. And I don't think that Matt expected them to return. So it's not a shock that they're there and trying to go for a grad year one more time and make some cash here, right?
I'm probably more in shock Mason Gillis still has another year of eligibility.
He's been around for a bit. I think he may have also graduated in 2008 with you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he was on Newcastle's golf team there. Hell, he probably redshirted because I think he was hurt his senior year of high school. Yeah, I mean, Purdue's going to look – I mean, they're going to look a lot different. They're going to play a lot different. I don't – unless Will Berg all of a sudden, slides in the starting lineup, I mean, even if it's Kaufman Wren as the post guy, I mean – if they want to, they could be, we'll see if Kanan Ketchings can play from day one. But, I mean, Colvin and Heidi and, Lawyer and Glenn Robinson's kid is a top, top 100 guard. I mean, it's going to look a lot different. It's going to be, normal, maybe isn't the right word, but it's going to be a little bit more traditional, I would think, from a guard and wing standpoint compared to most college basketball teams. So, it'll be fascinating to see it. It's not going to be, anywhere near the, play through the 7-4 guy for whatever, 80% of the game, 90% of the game.
So Kevin Bowen, the morning wake-up call with KB and Andy. His counterpart is Andy Sweeney. You can catch him weekday morning 7 until 10 a.m. here on The Fan. So what did you think about Indiana State? You see, there was a reason why that I went crazy about a team that made the NIT is because I knew – that it was all going to fall apart at the seams. I didn't even know, Kev, they had nine dudes on that team. I thought, all right, I thought they only had five or like seven. I had no idea they had nine. All nine in. Interim head coach and Matt Graves, interim AD at Angie Lansing, and a complete clown that can't hit the door quick enough, as President Deb is going to do later on this summer, thank goodness. A complete clown is president. The fact that they were able to navigate whatsoever under her ridiculous leadership. But then I think they're going to end up hiring somebody that had been with her in a couple of stops prior. So I guess some making some nice Indiana State decisions. I'm gonna have to get on the board of trustees over there or something. Holy crap. What are they doing?
Frankly, shocked that you're not on. I mean, if Quinn Buckner can be the head in Bloomington, I would think you could certainly.
I know it. I may have too long of a rap sheet in Vigo County to be a part of it. That may be part of it.
Well, it sounds like all they're missing is Dr. Chuck, and they would really round out the JMV trifecta here. Maybe he can take over as AD after this. Can you walk me through? And I brought this up to Andy today,
yes.
And we had people in the YouTube chat try to kind of speak for you. Walk me through interim head coach Matthew Graves. Why is the interim tag on it? Why not hire him full time?
I don't think that you're going to have any interest right now of anybody out there to be hired. Certainly, A, considering the situation, and I love Angie Lansing, and here's hoping she gets the athletic director job full time. But who's going to let themselves be hired by an interim AD, an AD that didn't hire them? Nobody. And then what do you do right now in this situation to where everything is absolutely unraveled at the seams? You bring back somebody that has been around it and somebody that is known in the area, and that is Matt Graves. And I know that Matt wants it, and I know that he's got backing of a lot of people over there, and frankly, I just don't know with the way this whole thing is set up. You've got an outgoing president that for whatever reason is still going to have input on the hire. She shouldn't have input on whether or not you go Coke or Pepsi at lunch, much less input on any future hires over there. So, yeah, it's an absolute mess, and I think that is maybe one situation where they want to look a little bit less messy. So that's is that a good enough explanation?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a sad explanation, and I hate that you have to.
And I love Matt.
In that manner.
I just don't think nobody's going to want to be hired by an interim AD. You want to be hired by the person that hired you.
Well, certainly no one wants to be hired by an interim AD. And then for Matt Graves, I mean, he's the lamest of all lame ducks.
He'd be the only one that would want to be hired by the interim AD because obviously that's what they just did.
But how is he going to build a roster with the interim tag?
Yeah,
I mean, there's a trickle-down effect. You know, why would a coach want to have the interim AD and why would the players want to have the interim coach? So, none of that makes sense. Whatsoever to me. I've been very confused by it all. And I mean, you've pretty much warned us of this. Like, I mean, you've been, you know, certainly hemming at it, saying it, however you want to describe it, you know, for several weeks. And now it's wild to think what a week ago, you know, less than a week ago, I mean, I'm driving by the Bulldog and the place is packed. And, I said it to you last Wednesday, I give credit for those guys just playing in the NIT. All five of them are in the portal. All five of them easily could have gotten in the portal 2 weeks ago, and who knows?
And then, like, three other dudes I've never heard of. Like, they were like, hey, this guy's on the – I go, wait a minute, who is that? I don't even know who that is. I mean, I knew the five dudes and then the two seniors in Bledson and Wolf that played, and then I knew that the Aaron Gray kid. I don't know what the hell happened to him, but he was, like, a talented guy that had to get through, and I don't know, the world in which we live, if you have eligibility issues right now, then you've got some issues, right? Because basically, it's like being in a crowd at an Oprah Winfrey show. You get eligibility. You get eligibility. Everybody gets eligibility. So to have issues in that capacity is weird. But, yeah, it's all gone to crap right now. And, unfortunately, that is probably what they're going to have to sit in for an extended period of time, and it's unfortunate.
You know, I don't know if you know, growing up in the state, maybe you're just kind of more ingrained in it. But, like, there's just something about the mid-major that I love. And it's endearing. And, you know, Butler, when I was growing up, was still labeled that. I mean, you had a Valpo run, obviously. You had an Indiana State run. And to that, like, you know, when you look at some of those teams, I mean, hell, IUPUI making the tournament with Ron Hunter. You know, all of that, just for some reason, it was so magnetic to me. And I don't see how you get that, you know, in like building it up through your town. And by that, I mean, you know, when you think of mid-major teams, often I feel like you think of, hey, these are the guys that have been together for 3 or 4 years and they, you know, whatever. They lost in the conference title game the year before and now they're ready, you know, to get over that hump, et cetera, et cetera. And then, you know, hopefully they do. And it's magical for Terre Haute or it's magical for Valpo or,
yep,
you know, any of that. And, you know, I just don't see how it happens. And to be totally fair and totally transparent, I mean, Indiana State has obviously benefited from the portal with Ryan Conwell.
Yes.
And
Isaiah Swope.
So it's not like it's just, you know, there's, I guess, a two-way street with, like, the Indiana States of the world of you've got the guys that obviously do well at your program, and you pointed out yesterday every Missouri Valley player, like, on these all-conference teams are obviously looking to trade up or to transfer up, and then you've got guys like Swope or, you know, like the UIndy guys following Paul Cassaro to IUPUI where, like, you know, now they get their opportunity to go to the D1 level, or in Ryan Connell's case, maybe you start at a higher level, I say higher in quotes, and whatever, you're homesick or et cetera, you want to get closer to home. So
people around here didn't think he could play. How about this? IUPUI didn't think, this is before obviously Paul, didn't think that Conwell nor Swope could play at that level. So, I mean, hell, no wonder they lost all their games. Holy crap.
No wonder Detroit beat them this year for their only win this season.
And again, to defend them in the transfer portal, you know, Swope wanted to try to play or have eligibility in an NCAA tournament, and Southern Indiana wasn't ready for that. I mean, he was overlooked by everybody, and it was awesome the way that he evolved. And the same with Ryan Conwell. I'm still going to follow them because they're enjoyable to watch, but they're enjoyable kids. I really grew to like them a great deal, having them on the show and being able to talk to them. So I wish nothing but the best for that entire group. But it's a mess. There's a mess left in the wake.
It sounds like a dumpster fire, to be honest with you.
Yeah, it is. And here's what you got to know, and this is all I've had to say about this in closing here, Kev, is you are where you are with this right now. All right? Here are the rules. You understood, even in an NIT run with this past year's group, how excited a fan base in Terre Haute and Vigo County in Western Indiana for Indiana State University, how excited they can be, how university and, you know, Terre Haute can work together for the first time and forever, can be one. You understand that capacity. Now go to work on understanding how to swim and not sink in the pool of the landscape of college basketball right now. That's what you got to do. And then no crying, no whining, hey, we're screwed, oh, woe is us. Get to stinking work and hire good people to do it and not just a bunch of clown shows that come in there for 5 minutes and ruin stuff and then leave. Get to work on it. That's all I'm asking. It's very simple here. Get to work.
And don't hire Dr. Chuck.
My God, that guy looked like he was asleep. See him at the end of that?
Trust me, that was, as soon as all of a sudden, you know, Ian Eagle or whoever's like, and we've got, you know, whatever his real name is, Charles, to hand it out. I'm like, boy, I hope JMV's turned to Skinamax at this point.
Yeah, so anyway, we'll see how it happens. Hey, I appreciate it, man. I know this is one of your favorite, if not your favorite, weekend. So enjoy that. Tell the family I said hello. And make sure that Sweebo is not angry by Pineapple Nick or the Captain Hook fish and chips reference right there. So
Shank and Fee now. Let's go.
I need one more. How about Matsuyama? Can I get a third, too, for a parlay?
All right.
Hideki Matsuyama, I'm going to add to the equation, all right?
I like it. That's a nice trio.
Yep. And you guys got Chuck Pagano in front of Chuck Strong and that thing coming up tomorrow, right?
Chuck Pagano tried for Andrew Luck.
Yes.
You know how that text conversation went and the response back? At least he did respond. But so, yes, Andrew Luck going to be there Friday night. So
did Andrew Luck respond to you?
He did. He actually did. Yeah, we it was not.
What did he say?
He was actually over.
I didn't even try.
Yeah, I think he was in Japan. I don't know what for. So yeah, after a couple of days of thinking, man, maybe the flip phone has changed to something else. He did. He actually gave me a nice response, a polite no. But I do think he is going to do some sort of media over there. I don't think the one-on-one necessarily is happening, but yeah, we'll have Chuck on tomorrow at 7:30.
He's following the band Young the Giant in Japan, probably.
With the edge of luck, you can tell me just about anything.
We're also checking out the latest in progressive architecture in Tokyo.
Exactly. So, right. Yeah. Frank Lloyd Wright has something that he wanted to go check out in Tokyo.
That's too simplex. We got to go to a higher level right there. All right, James is yelling at me right here. Just threw something at me. We're going to fight. I knew I should have shut the lights off on him when he was in the toilet earlier today. When I walked in there, I saw his shoes. I was going to shut the lights off, and I didn't. I should have. See you, brother.
See ya.
That's Bowen. Morning wake-up call, 7 until 10 a.m. He and Andy Sweeney, Kevin Bowen. All right. Benatar Giraldo tickets coming up. Got that for you as well. 93.5-107.5 The Fan.
Business. It's all.
JMV.
Now, you listen here. He's not the Messiah. He's a very naughty boy. Now, go away.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
AAA Membership Lounge via YouTube Live. Thank you guys for being a part of it again. This reminder, Carb Day 2024, May the 24th of 2024. Kid Quill, the opener. Shelbyville, Indiana, local talent from what they say. I got to get him on the show. George Thorogood and the Destroyers, the headliner. And this band in the background playing right now from Phoenix, Arizona. The Gin Blossoms, a part of it as well as a special guest. That is Carb Day 2024. Tickets available right now, IMS.com. I know that they're having practices out there today, a little preparation going on for the greatest spectacle in racing with a lot of cars before the rains came today. So it was good to have that back. Carb Day. And I know my man DJ Skids has asked, you know, DJ Skids of the JMV Takeover, the mini mixes, has asked if I could bring him out and have him DJ before and after me being on stage. I don't mind that as an idea. I think that's a good idea. We shall see. Tickets available again. Carb Day concert. George Thorogood and the Destroyers, Gin Blossoms, and Kid Quill. IMS.com for all you need to know. This is a really good question from Gutshot, which I may have to jot this down. This may be the first time he's ever had a really good question. So shout out to you, Gutshot. I'm obviously not as invested as you, but what is the logic in them keeping Graves when you couldn't keep shirts? Here it is. And it's what I mentioned to Kev a little bit earlier. It is having any form of continuity right now. And I don't want this to sound like a backhanded compliment at Matt. I hope that Matt has it. I know that Matt wants to be a head coach again. Matt wants to have a do-over after South Alabama. And I know that Matt wants to be a part of that area and this area. I know that Matt wants to play the same style of offense. And this is not meant at all as a backhanded compliment, because when there is a typhoon happening around you right now, to have a semblance, a sliver at all of normalcy, he certainly would bring that. And probably could bring back a couple of assistant coaches, I'm assuming there too. But the cut and the dry of it is, you don't have an athletic director. You have an outgoing president. That's a pain. And I just don't know what the market would be out there right now to get, you know, what you believe to be a fresh new start altogether if it's not Matt. Who's going to want to be hired by an AD that's not going to be there? Then you bring in the AD who didn't know you, has, you know, no relation or connection to you. And then coming into that situation where you're going to be playing me at shooting guard next year. So, again, it is not at all a shot at Matt. I am glad that Matt is taking that over. In fact, I'm going to give Matt credit, because there's no way in hell about 90% of the coaches would want to jack with that situation right now. I wouldn't. I mean, think about that. He's also getting hired, and I like Angie Lansing a great deal. But he's getting hired by an interim AD, and you've got an awful president that's outgoing and for some reason still has say in all this. I don't see another alternative unless somebody can present it to me. So that is the long form story of it, Gutshot, right there. And I talked to Matt for a long time last Thursday after the game, and he knew this was all coming. And a lot of people suggest, well, you know, Josh Schertz, had he stayed, you know, he could bring all five back. All five of those guys were leaving anyway. Like, the stars of that team, all five of those guys were going to leave, even with Schertz staying. That's where we are right now. Why? Is because the NIL budget at Indiana State is probably what I have in my wallet right now. It's not enough. And you got guys that want to take advantage of the financial structure and get theirs right then and right now. And then you add the fact that all five of those dudes were all over national television coverage, became well known, and each, even with Conwell having a bad game, and he got hit in the head early, and he gutted that thing out. But even with Ryan Conwell having a bad shooting game, he's still viewed as a $500,000 NIL deal player. I blank you not on that. So is Robbie Avila. And then you got Jason Kinn, and then you got Isaiah Swope that's around a quarter of a mil. You guys laugh at that. You scoff at it. But people in the know will tell you that that's accurate. Just a semblance of normalcy in a situation is far from it. Is gutshot exactly why that is the path that they're taking. And people are talking that I haven't talked to Matt, so I don't know if they're about ready to get something done outside the interim basis. But that is where they are right now with that program. And that's why I told you last week and the weeks leading up to embrace it, because like a house of cards, it was all going to fall in. And Matt's going to be there to pick up those pieces and probably will pay a toll for doing that himself. Tony's at 239-1070. Hello, Tony. How are you?
All right, JMP. How you doing?
Tony, I'm great. Thanks for the call.
Oh, no problem, man. Hey, I just wanted to kind of reach out and speak about the guy with the bet.
Yes, please do.
Winning the division.
Please do.
I'm going to nerd out just for a hot second here. Basically, after tonight, Milwaukee hosts Orlando. Giannis is out.
Yes.
So that's why the money went up.
Exactly.
And if Orlando wins tonight, the money's probably going to go up again tomorrow night.
Right on.
Here's the problem. Milwaukee plays OKC at OKC on Friday. They may host them. And then they've got Orlando back again on Sunday. Now, Orlando might be playing still to improve their position. One thing I wanted to say to you, JMV, is the Pacers all week long, it's been strictly up to the Pacers. They can finish in the five hole regardless of what anybody does by beating Cleveland and just winning out. I'd like you to put the pressure back on the team and say it's in their hands.
Yes.
They win tomorrow night and they win Sunday. They're no worse than fifth. And then we can go all the way up to third. We can't get to second. This is a nerdy part because Orlando's playing Milwaukee twice. And if Orlando wins two games, they will stay in front of us because they've got a game up and the tiebreaker. So it's really in New York is playing Boston, but who knows if Boston's actually going to try to play. Then they close out with the Nets and Chicago.
Yeah. Hey, Tony, I got to run like here really quick. I went
no
way
problem.
Over. Put a quick bow. I don't want to be disrespectful here. Put a quick bow on
it. That's it. It's just we've never seen anything like this where playoff spots have come down to virtually the last game for the whole conference.
Gotcha, buddy. I appreciate your call and clarifying that.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
All right, 239-1070. We do not have anything goes. James is freaking out over there because I'm going long. We're all good. I mean, what the hell? Nobody's around here to get mad. Anyway, we run this place with no windows. Back with you next.
We all hear the radio ads about the IRS. They tell you to be afraid, to be scared, and they try to frighten you into calling. I'm not here to do that. Tax Relief Advocates is different. TRA is here to tell you that if you owe money to the IRS, whether it's $5,000, $50,000, or $500,000, we have a solution. It doesn't matter if you're sitting in your car, at work, or with your kids, no matter where you are, call now. 800-575-6759. Don't lose hope. TRA can eliminate or reduce what you owe to the IRS. There is zero risk to you. If we can't reduce your tax debt, then you pay nothing. Our passion is taxes and helping individuals fix their IRS problems. We have a 5-star rating on Google and an A+ with the Better Business Bureau. You don't need to be afraid of the IRS any longer. End your tax nightmare today by visiting us online at TRA.com or call 800-575-6759. That's 800-575-6759. Tax Relief Advocates, real solutions for real people.
Hey, it really worked out for me. It will for you as well. My friends at QC Kinetics. I just played hoop last night until 11 o'clock, and I was really at the age of 54, unable to do things like that, or at least the pain in my knee was taking its toll. And I'd done all the drugs and the downtime and the surgery that come with that. But with QC Kinetics, they got to the very root of the issue right here. It's my own concentrated healing properties. Really, it's PRP. They shake it up, put it back in your knee, in my case right here. It feels great. It really does. You can do it with your hip, shoulder, back, knee, just like me. But stay in the game is the focus right here. And you can do it with Drew and the gang at QC Kinetics. And response has been so huge. They have expanded the hours now to include Saturday appointments. So take advantage and keep going longer without the pain. With QC Kinetics, 317-559-PAIN, Eagle Creek, Greenwood, and Carmel. That's 317-559-PAIN, QC Kinetics. Tell them I sent you. 317-559-PAIN.
Over $10,000. That's the average amount of money people in the U.S. are now spending on gas, groceries, and dining in a year. 10 grand. That's crazy. You have to download Upside, the free app that gives you cash back every time you get gas, groceries, and dine out. That's right. You can earn real cash back with Upside just for buying the things you're already buying. You can literally start earning cash back today.
With JMV.
He's my best friend. He's my pal. He's my homeboy. My rotten soldier. He's my sweet cheese. My good time boy.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Pat Benatar and husband Neil Giraldo. That is going to be at Everwise Amphitheater, White River State Park. You will not want to miss this. Pat Benatar puts on a great show, July the 27th. Crank this up right here. The Legend of Billie Jean theme song, James. Crank it. That Helen Slater, Legend of Billie Jean? She was smoke. There's no bra wearing in that film from the Legend. Billie Jean wasn't rocking a bra. I would have given that, like, the Academy Award Best Picture. The Legend of Billie Jean, the Academy Award for Best Picture. Most scenes braless. Number 9 at 239-1070 is a winner. Enjoy those. The NFL informed clubs today it has revised the uniform policy to allow teams a third helmet design, as if two was certainly not enough. The expansion was offered to the teams that were going through the redesign process for the 2024 season. Now open to all clubs for the 2025 season, the three-helmet design rule, according to Tom Pelissero, in place. Ethan Morton and Mason Gillis of Purdue into the transfer portal, as we talked about earlier today. And nobody's surprised by that. They're going to be grad students into the transfer portal. And I saw this from our friend Rick Simler over in Terre Haute as we were talking about that a moment ago. Matthew Graves and Indiana State in talks. And Matt's a strong candidate to become the next head coach. I talked to him about that last week. I know he wanted that even before Josh left because he knew Josh was leaving. But Graves has been the associate head coach with Josh Schertz for the past 3 years. Of course, former Butler assistant, former Butler player. Did not have a good time down in Mobile at South Alabama, but a little calm in the storm that is going on with that program over in Terre Haute. So expect that to be done here relatively soon. Matt Graves. I think Jake wants to get Matt on the show, and I told Jake to reach out to him. At some point, we'll talk to Matt as well. I'm going to get Josh Schertz on also at some point, too. James, great job out of you today. Everybody, thank you so much for being a part. This was a fun show with a Pacer conversation with Chris Denary, with an everything, including golf and the Masters conversation with Kevin Bowen. Podcast 1075thefan.com. Ted Bishop on the show coming up tomorrow. Absolutely cannot wait to have the former PGA of America Prez on to talk about the Masters. Chapel and draft conversation, too. That's all tomorrow beginning at 3. Stay dry tonight. Have a great evening. We'll be back with you right here tomorrow. 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Have a great night.